Go ahead and show them.
I may now call upon Mr. S. Sundar Ranjan, CEO of Janani Foods, for his elevator pitch.
Huge supply side gap between the organized sector technology providers and the farmers. So I try to fill through franchising based chaos at the village levels and aggregating at the mandal levels to again the purchasing model. The services that we give is ESAGO Agro Service, input supplies, seeds, fertilizers, pesticides, financial and insurance services through organized sector, farm information services, management and market linkage services. The revenue is through subscriptions, margins from the trading, and also commission from the service providers. We are tying up with the TCS AP Online for the franchise infrastructure. There are over 700 franchises in rural Andhra Pradesh. And IBM is going to provide the technology platform for the hardware, software, and other things. We have marketing, we are giving various channel options for the farmers. And we have done this pilot in 3 centers, and we are planning to go up to 75. We will be breaking even in the 3rd year, and we need 2 crores immediately. Thank you.
All right. Now, I'll thank you, Mr. Sundar. And now I may call upon Ms. Neha from Grameen Infra to give their elevator pitch.
We are Greenway Grameen Infra. We are a company that is dedicated to producing, designing, and of course deploying products which are tailored for the rural market. We don't have a presentation, that's just a glimpse of the 3 products that we would be launching by this September. We have a store which we believe is the most efficient and easy to use, most efficient performance-wise and easy to use stove in the natural dark stove space. Jubnu, a waste heat-based LED and mobile charger, which we'll be piloting next month, and a point-of-use water purification device. The idea about product development and the philosophy is that we co-create with people. So essentially, we live with people, see what they need, and design as per their price point expectations as well as their expectations of performance. And of course, we are a very technology-oriented company. Our present products are also the result of over a lakh of kilometers traveled across 5 states in the country to see what people like, what the sales triggers are, and designed with a price point in mind. That's about it. The target is to reach 1.5 million households by 2015, and we've just started selling on the 16th of March, and we would be reaching 8,000 households by the end of this month. Thank you.
Minute time is too less for an elevator pitch. Just like 3 hours are never enough for an exam. So, but then this is how life is. So, okay.
Before we begin our panel discussion, to set direction to the course, we will have a presentation by Mr. Satish Pai from the Investment Banking Group of Intellicap.
Good afternoon, everybody. We have seen a lot of businesses who are trying to engage with small producers. But one key question is, what is the investability of these models? Over the last 2 to 3 years, there's been considerable investor interest in these models dealing with small producers, precisely because consumers have become more and more demanding of the quality of the produce that they consume. And so there is a need to ensure control over that quality. And so businesses need to integrate backwards. And a new wave of entrepreneurs have come in who realize what it takes to work with small producers. And they realize it's a long-term game, especially because these farmers and producers have to be provided with a lot of technical inputs and advice. And so it's a very long-term game. From the investor point of view, the one key concern is scalability, because for them, ultimately, they are trying to get out after 5 to 7 years, making a return of 25-30%. But the problem in these models has been that it takes about 5 to 7 years just to stabilize the business, and investors are still not very clear what the scalability of these models is. So in the past, in FY10, for example, out of the $200 million of capital which flowed into the agribusiness sector, only a very small fraction actually flowed into businesses which deal directly with producers or farmers. It would seem, given the economics of disintermediation, that it's a natural course of action for businesses. But actually, that has not happened. Very few businesses have managed to pull it off. And one of the reasons is that businesses have not been able to build the kind of long-term trust that is necessary to work with farmers and to work with farmers in the long term. And there are challenges in disintermediation, especially because farmers are price maximizers, farmers or producers for that matter. They go to whoever offers them the best price, and so building sort of long-term relationships becomes all the more difficult. And there have been a few success stories, especially in Punjab in the contract farming side, where producers, companies have engaged with farmers who have been producing crops which have which do not have alternative markets. And so they have to necessarily supply to that particular company. And so as a result, the business have been able to build long-term relationships with these producers. And there are various models of producer engagement, starting from the plain vanilla procurement contracts to like total contracts where the business takes complete control over the farming process. Now, each of these models have implications in terms of the scalability of the model and the control that they exercise over the produce. And in the Indian context, the best model that seems to be applicable is the procurement plus input contracts, where the businesses supply both technical advice and inputs. And this works especially in cases where the produce does not have alternative markets and businesses, the farmers have necessarily supplied to this particular businesses. And there are other models like corporate farming, where businesses actually lease in land either from high net worth individuals or farmers and then cultivate that land. And there are various permutations and combinations of this model that are in vogue in the moment. But the question, that's the key question that we have to answer, is are these models actually inclusive of small farmers? Especially because there is huge transaction costs in dealing with small farmers. And from the small farmers' point of view, there is a risk in technological upgradation, and sometimes it may be capex heavy also using these models. So from the investor point of view, it's very clear these models are very, very attractive. Basically, they transform a business which is essentially a commodity, low margin business, to a kind of a productized business, where the business is able to build brand value both on the supply chain side and on the demand side. And by creating, by building those relationships with the producers, they sort of create a barrier to entry for new businesses and their competitors to come in. But there are certain questions that come out of these kind of models, especially relating to scalability, because ultimately these businesses kind of rely a great lot on building relationships with producers. So the question is, how do you scale up these businesses over, even from one state to another? Somebody's working in, say, Punjab, how does he replicate that model in, say, Madhya Pradesh? So these are very important questions that we that investors look to answer. So now maybe we can now turn to the panel for the discussion.
Thank you, Satish, and that was a very enlightening speech and presentation. Now we shall have the panel discussion on the rise of investable farming models in India, the bone of contention, whether it is or not. The moderators for this discussion are, may I call upon Mr. Paul Basil, founder of Willgrow, which is the incubator for upcoming innovations in the social enterprise sector. Among his achievements, he co-founded the Lemelson Recognizing and Mentoring Program for Innovation in collaboration with IIT Madras. He has also been a founding team member of Kerala Horticulture Development Program, and we welcome you, Mr. Paul. Now, may I call upon Mr. Anil Sinha, second moderator, who heads the International Finance Corporation in Delhi. IFC promotes sustainable private sector investment in developing countries. Mr. Sinha has more than 28 years' experience in private sector development, ranging from project design and implementation to consulting. He has worked in Zimbabwe, Hanoi, Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, and Nigeria in various positions and responsibilities. There have been some changes in the original panel. Our panelists now are Mr. Ian Rao, Executive Director of Tirumala Milk. He helped co-found Tirumala Milk as a private sector dairy. Our next panelist is Mr. Bjorn Witte. He is the Managing Director of Desai Foods and Vegetables Private Limited. Desai Foods is the largest banana producer and exporter so far in our country. Mr. Bjorn has a background in business administration. He has done management consulting and corporate performance management. He is currently based in India and truly believes in the potential of agriculture as an investment. Next, I would like to call upon Mr. Hemendra Mathur. He is the Managing Director for SEAF, India Agribusiness International Fund. Prior to working for SEAF, Hemendra worked with Yes Bank, Rabo India Finance, Kurt Salman Associates, and